Thank you all for coming. Can I just check that we have a good connection to New York City?
Yep. We can hear you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I'd like to call this meeting of the Board on Electric Generation Siting and the Environment to order. Before moving to the agenda, I would like to introduce the alternates representing the permanent members of the Siting Board. We have Lou Alexander, alternative Basil Sagos, Department of Environmental Conservation. We've got Elizabeth Lewis-Michael, alternative Howard Zucker, Department of Health. In New York, we have Vincent Ravshear, alternate for Eric Gertler, Acting Commissioner, New York State Department of Economic Development, and President and Chief Executive Officer Designate of Empire State Development. And we have John Williams, also in New York City, alternative Richard Kaufman, New York State Energy Research and Development Authority. Also, I would like to introduce the ad hoc members of the Siting Board. We have Leslie Sheldon, and we have William Shaw. Now I turn to you, Acting Secretary Phillips. Are there any changes to the agenda?
There are no changes to the agenda.
Thank you. So let's get started. We're going to discuss case 16F0328, application of Number 3 Wind, LLC, for a certificate of environmental compatibility and public need pursuant to Article 10 for construction of a wind project located in Lewis County, presented by Maureen Leary, Administrative Law Judge, Department of Public Service. We also have Molly McBride, Administrative Law Judge, Department of Environmental Conservation. We have James McClymans, Chief ALJ of the Department of Environmental Conservation. We have Ashley Moreno, Acting Chief ALJ of the Department of Public Service, and Bob Rosenthal, General Counsel of the Department of Public Service, all available to answer questions. Judge Leary, please begin.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Rhodes and members of the Siting Board. My name is Maureen Leary. I am the presiding examiner in this proceeding in which Number 3 Wind seeks a certificate of environmental compatibility and public need pursuant to Article 10 of the Public Service Law. As the Chair has noted, with me is Chief Judge James McClymans from the Department of Environmental Conservation, my colleague Molly McBride, also from DEC, and Acting Chief Judge Ashley Moreno. This team, as well as many members of senior staff, were instrumental during the entire proceeding and as well as in presenting the order today to the Siting Board. I will offer hopefully brief remarks today on the item before you, which is a proposed order and certificate with conditions to be issued by the Siting Board granting a certificate. The certificate is subject to detailed commissions, including a site engineering and environmental plan, which I will refer to today as a SEEP. Both of these are, that is the conditions and the SEEP, are included as appendices A and B to the proposed order. This order authorizes Number 3 Wind to construct and operate a commercial scale wind electric generating facility in the towns of Lowville and Harrisburg, which are located in Lewis County, New York. The project will consist of up to 31 turbines having a total maximum generating capacity of 105.8 megawatts. The order also authorizes associated facilities, including 12.5 miles of access roads, 32 miles of underground collection lines, a substation, two permanent meteorological towers of approximately 200 feet in height, an operations and maintenance building, a construction laydown yard, a point of interconnection switch yard, transmission lines, and other interconnection facilities that will connect the project to New York's electric system grid via National Grid's Lowville-Brayman 115 kilovolt transmission line. The Article 10 review process here was fair and open and included the award of pre-application and post-application intervener funding. Public notice was provided with respect to all significant milestones in the case. There were multiple instances of community outreach and education and numerous opportunities for public participation. The applicant sponsored open house events, maintained a website, and established a toll-free telephone number for public questions and comments. The Department of Public Service held two information sessions in Lowville, followed by on-the-record public statement hearings in the Lowville project area. Party status and pre-application and application phase intervener funding was awarded to the towns of Lowville and Harrisburg. Party status and application stage intervener funding was also awarded to the Tug Hill Alliance for Rural Preservation, also known as THARP. THARP participated throughout the proceeding. The proposed order before you is based upon an extensive evidentiary record that supports all of the findings and conclusions the siting board must make under Public Service Law Article 10, specifically Public Service Law Section 168. The record consists of number 3 Wind's application, the party's expert testimony and exhibits, among other things. It was compiled during an evidentiary hearing held over a 3-day period from May 13th to May 15th in the town of Lowville, at which witness testimony was taken on the record and other evidence admitted. The examiners and the parties also conducted site visits to facility component locations during that time frame. Although this was a fully litigated case, the parties were able to resolve some limited issues raised in the proceeding following the evidentiary hearing. This resolution was contained in a June 2019 stipulation among certain parties. Throughout the proceeding, project information was widely available to the public through various means, including the Department of Public Services Management Document and Matter Management System. Approximately 44 comments were submitted to DMM by the public throughout the Article 10 process, starting in 2018 and continuing through October 2019. Those who support the project in these comments cited the economic benefits to the local area, including new and temporary jobs, pilot payments, and the need for renewable energy in our state. Project opponents cited, among other things, adverse impacts on wildlife, concerns about health impacts due to noise and shadow flicker, aviation and lighting impacts, adverse economic impacts on tourism and local businesses, and the cumulative visual impacts associated with the facility and two other nearby wind farms known as the Maple Ridge Wind Farm, having 195 turbines, and the Copenhagen Wind Farm with 40 turbines. In general, those opposing the project indicate that the adverse impacts of the project outweigh its benefits. Notably, the two host towns in which the project will be located, Lowville and Harrisburg, have indicated no objections to the project. THARP continues to oppose the project on several grounds, including deficiencies in number 3 Wind's public participation efforts, adverse human health impacts, adverse socioeconomic impacts on area tourism, and adverse visual impacts. In the order, the agreed-upon certificate conditions executed by the parties in the June 2019 stipulation have been adopted. Some have been revised, however, and other conditions have been added for purposes of both clarity and consistency with orders issued in other Article 10 proceedings, most notably Barren Winds and Casadega Wind. On the whole, the order and certificate conditions the siting board is adopting here seek to address the identified impacts of the project, including the impacts that have been the subject of adjudication by the parties and comments by the public. Pursuant to Public Service Law Section 168, the order includes findings by the board that the probable environmental impacts of the construction and operation of the project will be minimized or avoided to the maximum extent practicable, based upon Number 3 Wind's compliance with the order and the certificate conditions in Appendices A and B. Pursuant to Public Service Law 168.3, the order includes a finding that the project will be constructed and operated in compliance with all applicable local laws. Section 168.3e specifically provides the board may not grant a certificate for the construction or operation of a major electric generation facility unless the board determines that the facility is designed to operate in compliance with applicable state and local laws and regulations. Here, Number 3 Wind sought a waiver of substantive local laws governing the siting of wind facilities from the towns of Lowville and Harrisburg. In its application, Number 3 requested that the siting board authorize the towns to exercise that authority and grant a procedural waiver of certain substantive laws governing the wind facilities. Those laws included setback requirements, collection and transmission line undergrounding, and several other requirements. In this citing board, I'm sorry, in this order, the citing board rejects the request, citing its determination in Casadega Wind and the examiner's recommended decision. The citing board here reiterates that allowing municipalities to waive the substantive provisions of local law would undermine the Article 10 process by allowing local municipalities to preempt the board's waiver authority. The order here also finds that Section 1683 that the citing board elects not to apply the local laws in whole or part upon finding that compliance is unreasonably burdensome. Under the Article 10 regulations, the applicant has the burden of seeking the citing board's waiver of a substantive law in the first instance and of showing that it is unreasonably burdensome. In this order, the citing board is treating number 3 Wind's waiver request to the towns as a waiver request to the citing board itself. The board considers the towns' waivers of these local laws as indicative of their expressed desire, and as local home ruling municipalities, their desire to waive certain substantive local requirements is telling. In the order, the citing board finds that the record is deficient to support waiver of certain substantive local laws and that number 3 Wind should comply with those requirements. The citing board also finds that the record is sufficient to support the waiver of other substantive local laws and has granted a waiver of those. The proposed order differs from the examiner's recommended decision in certain respects. For example, the examiners proposed the citing board's adoption of a condition that would establish a short-term regulatory noise limit of 42 dBA LEQ 8-hour for non-participating residences and 52 dBA LEQ 8-hour for participating residences. In this order, the citing board departs from this recommendation by noting that in Barron Winds, it established a short-term regulatory limit of 45 dBA LEQ 8-hour at non-participating residences and 55 dBA LEQ 8-hour at participating residences with a 5 dBA tonal penalty. The citing board here finds that at those levels, noise impacts from this project would be avoided and minimized to the maximum extent practicable. It made that very finding in Barron Winds. The citing board left open the possibility that the evolving scientific area related to human exposure to noise may result in different levels being established by the citing board in the future. Notably, the order also adopts the site engineering and environmental plan specifications I referred to earlier as SEEP specifications, which are attached as Appendix B. The SEEP specifications, the conditions require compliance filings to be consistent with the SEEP specifications. Those specifications will guide the certificate holder's sequence submissions to DPS staff and other parties, and allow for efficiencies in obtaining limited notices to proceed with construction activities. In summary, the order includes the board's required findings pursuant to Public Service Law Section 1683, namely that the project as a renewable generation facility is a beneficial addition to or substitution for the existing electric generation capacity of the state, that the construction and operation of the project will serve the public interest, that the probable environmental impacts of the construction and operation of the facility will be minimized or avoided to the maximum extent practicable, that the project does not have an adverse disproportionate environmental impact on environmental justice communities, that the project is consistent with the state's energy policies and the long-range planning objectives and strategies contained in the most recent state energy plan, and that the project is designed to operate in compliance with applicable state and local laws and regulations. In making these findings, the Siting Board also considered additional factors as noted in the order. That includes the state of available technology, the nature and economics of reasonable alternatives to the project, the project's environmental and community character impacts, the project's impacts on related facilities, utilities, and communications, and additional social, economic, visual, and aesthetic considerations. The examiners and Judges Moreno and McClyman and members of senior advisory staff are available for any questions the members of the siting board may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll make a few comments and then turn to my colleagues. Kind of the clear and important goal in our work as a siting board is to approve and only approve appropriately sited projects, importantly including renewable projects which serve the environmental and energy needs and goals of the state. When I think about my how I'm going to approach this, I look mainly at two factors. I look at the conditions that are going to apply to this project, conditions that address and mitigate to the best extent possible health issues like noise, environmental issues that generally often have to do with species that we care about, economic issues that can be both positive and negative, and community concerns, which are their business. And I also care, and I find that these are well treated. They're approached with great seriousness, and I think the resolution of all these issues strikes a very good balance, and we need to strike that balance, and it strikes a balance after having, I don't know if this is the right word, but engineered the best solution possible. I also care about inclusion. It matters a great deal to me and also to the legitimacy of what we do, that parties have a chance to speak and be heard. I care about inclusion. I care about transparency. I look to see that there's ample and meaningful public participation, and that there's a party resolution to the maximum possible. That's how I view each case. I note for the record that I also like consistency. Where it makes sense in an individual case, consistency is a good thing. So I'm going to be in favor of this recommendation. Lou, do you have any comments or questions you'd like?
I do have a couple of questions and comments. Thank you, Chairman Rhodes. In reviewing the record, it had raised some questions for me. However, the proposed order and today's presentation has answered virtually all of them. I still have a couple that I would like to pose. The first deals with the sort of hierarchy of documents. We have before us an order, certificate conditions, a attachment A to appendix A, required filings, as well as the SEEP. And it's my understanding that if there is inconsistencies between the attachment A, the required filings, and the SEEP, and the certificate conditions, it's the certificate conditions that control.
That is correct.
And in terms of these two documents, the SEEP and the required filings, is there any thought given to the possibility, perhaps in the future, to integrating those two documents rather than having separate documents, only from the perspective that the more documents you have, the more chance of some sort of perceived inconsistency?
The inclusion of attachment A was done for the purpose of respecting the agreement reached by the parties, which the examiners felt was important to foster in this case. That, as I think you may be correct, absolutely, in terms of could there be confusion. This was certainly the subject of great discussion, and at the end of the day, we think that the document as a whole adequately explains that the certificate and order and certificate conditions govern over any of the provisions of the SEEP specifications, as well as what I'll call attachment A, which are required filings. So those are more for explanatory purposes, but in any event, the certificate itself, as well as the certificate conditions, governs. Yes, there was, I believe there, without speaking out of school, there certainly is consideration of one attachment, one document, or perhaps maybe maximum two. But future cases, I think the citing board will certainly not necessarily go this way unless the parties have, you know, there's a good reason to, and the parties reaching an agreement here that was entitled to some level of respect. Notably, as I noted in the presentation, Even the conditions that were agreed to were, you know, tweaked and revised to an extent by the siting board for purposes of clarity and consistency.
Thank you. My second question deals with grassland bird habitat. I know from, you know, reading certain of the documents in the record, certain parties sort of focused on this 3-to-1 mitigation ratio. But from reviewing the order and some of the other materials, it seems that a simple focus on 3-to-1 ignores the fact that this is a more sophisticated approach, which takes into account a succession of grassland habitat over time. You know, is my understanding that this is a more nuanced approach, you know, correct? That's what the order would seem to imply.
I think that's right. I'm going to defer to my colleagues from DEC on responding more specifically.
That's correct. It would be wrong to think that it's as simple as a 3-to-1, and it's important that you read the details contained in the documents to understand the rationale and reasoning behind it. A great deal of effort went into this with DEC staff, and it's important that all those details be looked at.
Thank you. In terms of decommissioning, I know that there has been a look at what happens at the end of the day. And, you know, I see from the order and the certificate condition 45 that we address things such as an irrevocable letter of credit. There was discussion regarding the salvage issue. In terms of where we are at the end of the road, will the letter of credit be sufficient? Are there other things that will be taken into account in the final decommissioning plan?
Yes, the most important thing here is that the towns would be protected at the end of the project life. And so the letter of credit as an instrument, specifically that instrument, was required or is required in the certificate conditions here as a result of the quality of that particular instrument. There are additional requirements of an analysis of what decommissioning costs will be over time, to their cost of living or other increases associated with decommissioning these facilities will be reviewed every 5 years. We think that the towns are fully capable of overseeing this process, but there is a mechanism to communicate with DPS staff in this regard. The estimate for decommissioning will be revised over the life of the project, and that estimate will not include the salvage value of the components, in large part because it's unclear today what the value would be at the end of the project life. So that is the reason for the way that the certificate conditions are structured on the letter of credit and the decommissioning requirements. It's important, I believe, for the siting board to protect the towns in this instance.
Thank you. And my last question was more of a comment. As I understand from this order and the presentation today, that with respect to local laws, Article 10 applicants must present requests for waiver of local substantive laws to the siting board in the first instance. Is that correct?
That is correct. And yet, you know, one of the things that is noted in this order is the recommendation that applicants work closely with host towns, as the applicant did here. That is to be respected. That is to be fostered. Because this is their community, and it's important for the applicant to gain their input and their confidence, et cetera. So the order here, while it does take a firm line on the appropriate procedure to follow if there's a waiver of substantive laws sought, it still seeks to continue to foster communications with towns that are really critical to the success of these projects.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the answers to the questions I had. Back to the chair.
Thank you. Betsy, do you have any comments or questions?
I have no comments or questions.
Thank you. Vince, any comments or questions?
No questions, thank you.
John Williams?
No questions.
I will now turn to the ad hoc colleagues on the board. Leslie, do you have any comments or questions?
One that I know of. Can you clarify the issue of the aircraft detection lighting system, the ALDS? Is that a condition that would be enforced by number 3 Wind?
The aircraft detection lighting system, or ADLS, is a mechanism for aircraft to see the turbine towers. And because of the location of Fort Drum Air Base, it was really critically important that their interests be served here. What this order does is essentially defer to the Department of Defense and the lighting that they will require for these turbines. Notably, though, Maple Ridge with 195 turbines and Copenhagen with 40 additional turbines all have lighting. And I suspect, I do not know, but that had to be approved by Fort Drum as well. So the Department of Defense is probably the most critical player in this, because what works for the air base is certainly important. So ADLS, if it's required by the Department of Defense, are in an agreement that we understand the applicant has reached. If that's required, that is what will be on the turbines. But this order really defers to the federal interest here.
Okay. Thank you.
Bill, any comments or questions? I'm sorry, I'm not on. Bill, any comments or questions?
Yes, I did come in late in the game, and I reflect upon the role I'm supposed to play in this, in protecting the public and the concerns of the local municipality, the residents of Lowville and Lewis County. And I sit here so very impressed in all the work that's gone into this, the questions that have been asked and answered through the process to get to where we are today. And I feel that all aspects are so many details have been gone through, and I'm proud to be part of this, and I do see that both sides have had to compromise to an extent, but in the better interest of economics, I do support this project.
Thank you. Thank you. So with that, I will now proceed to the next step, which is to call for a vote, and we'll vote one by one. My own vote is in favor of the recommendation to approve the application of number 3 Wind LLC for a certificate of environmental compatibility and public need with conditions as described. Mr. Alexander, how do you vote?
I also vote in favor.
Dr. Lewis Michael, how do you vote?
In favor.
Mr. Ravishier, how do you vote?
In favor.
Mr. Williams, how do you vote?
In favor.
Ms. Sheldon, how do you vote?
The negative impacts outweigh the benefits. I vote no.
Mr. Schaub, how do you vote?
I vote in favor.
The matter is approved and the recommendation is adopted. Acting Secretary Phillips, is there anything further to come before us today?
No, there's not.
Okay. Thank you very much. We are adjourned.